Hello and a very warm welcome to a cosmic collector's lot special. Today we're leaving Earth as we know it and celebrating celestial collectibles relating to the universe, space travel and UFOs. We meet a man who's seeking to put Britain at the heart of the space race with his collection of rockets. And Wild Thing Reg Presley shows off a collection of crop circle photographs which are simply out of this world. And for you avid Trekkies out there, Laura Beaumont visits a convention in Essex. To that rocket collection first, and a visit to the headquarters of the Star Chaser Foundation in Manchester. Steve Bennett's mission is to design a rocket capable of offering space tours for people like you and me, and he's built up his collection of 40 prototype rockets over the last 20 years or so. Ken Snowden went to meet this man with astronomical aspirations which don't always go according to plan.
The dream of putting men into space can sometimes have humble origins. Steve Bennett has been building and designing rockets since he was 13. They were cheap and simple affairs, but they worked. 21 years later, he's still building rockets. In fact, he has a whole collection of them, but they're neither simple nor cheap. His last one cost £70,000. Oh, and he's no longer designing them on the kitchen table at home.
Steve, it's quite a hefty prize, isn't it, for the first person to put three people into space?
There is. There's an American consortium called the XPRIZE Foundation. They're offering $10 million to the first group or individual that can launch people into space and recover them safely.
Well, let's have a look at your designs, your collection of designs, to help you do that.
Well, here, in this book, this goes back a few years. I guess I was about 16 years old when I was sort of putting these little rockets together. They look something like this. This is a model rocket. You can buy these in the shops, but what I was using was very similar to this. And we've come on a little bit since then. They got a little bit bigger and better.
What was the next stage after you got the fundamentals out of the way?
Well, the rockets sort of increased in size. And pretty soon, well, I guess it was about 6 years ago, and we put this rocket together. This is half of Star Chaser 1A. We got that up about five or six times, and we got up a few thousand feet. Reused it. The principle was to kick parachutes out and get it back, and then it bring the cost down, just like the space shuttle.
So how's the technology changed? Because the early models, didn't they use sugar and fertilizer to get them off the ground?
Well, we did used to use sugar once upon a time, but we've moved on to more potent forms of propulsion now. It's really professional equipment. This book, for example, this sort of covers the most recent project, Star Chaser 3. It's sort of an operator's manual, and I've put that together, and members of my team refer to that when putting the rocket together. It's no longer a one-man band.
Now, what got you started?
Well, I think that goes back to when I was about 4 or 5 years old. It was the Gerry Anderson Productions, you know, Thunderbirds, that sort of thing. I knew it wasn't real, but I wanted to make it real. It was the Walt Disney in me, and I think that's been the driving force, you know, all the way along the line, you know. I had this dream, this ambition, I wanted to bring it alive, you know, I wanted to make it happen.
And have you kept all the documents, everything that you've written right from the start, right to now?
Yeah, I've got a huge collection of documents, plans, you name it, you know, when I'm dead and buried, other people will be able to carry on the work. And there's also one or two rockets dotted about, which form quite a nice collection.
Star Chaser 3 was the latest launch. Did it all go according to plan?
Star Chaser 3 sort of hit the deck quite hard. We got it up a few hundred feet, it turned around and hit the deck. There was a technical problem with that. It was a problem that was anticipated, and I thought we'd covered it, but obviously not enough.
So this is the rocket graveyard, is it, Steve?
Absolutely. This is where all the rockets come to die.
Poor things. Oh, dear.
Yes, sir.
Oh, dearie me. It's in a few bits, isn't it?
There's not a lot left.
Do you know what went wrong?
Yeah, there are 7 rocket motors powering the first stage. Now, the central motor and one of the outboard motors ignited first, and so the rocket sort of arced over and hit the side of the hill. The rest is history.
And who scrawled that graffiti on the fin there?
Yeah, that was sort of a good look from the rest of the team and the other students. I guess it didn't give us much luck in the long
run. Bigger rising time. So there's, what, £70,000 worth of rocket here?
Yes.
Any bits you can use next time?
Well, let's see. Things like these... these shackles we can use again. These are £2 or £3 a piece, so right. Might as well reuse those.
69,998.
Let's see. Then we've got this piece here. This piece, we could probably reuse that again. This is responsible for kicking out the parachutes for the top stage. So this would throw a couple of parachutes out.
And any idea when you'll be able to embark on number 3A?
Well, it's sort of cost dependent, so you know we need something like 20k to sort of get us moving again, but possibly 12 weeks, you know, if we have the right sponsorship.
I'm sure one day we'll get someone in space. Steve, thanks very much indeed.
Cheers, Ken.
Look, Steve's gone now. I've nicked this bit from his workshop. I reckon he'll be in outer space sooner rather than later. Look, he's getting some extra help. Mind you, I might just get there before him. Beam me up, Scotty.
Last I heard, he was fast approaching Mars. Talking of Scotty, it's a night out in Essex next with a group of Star Trek fans. We're not busy watching reruns of the show. Trekkies meet at conventions to swap tips on cosmic collectibles and to dine out on galactic menus. Laura Beaumont beamed herself down, passing Ken on the way, and boldly went where no other Collector's Lot presenter has gone before.
Captain's log, Stardate 81246, planet Upminster. I'm receiving signs of intelligent life. Collectors, this way.
Star Trekking across the universe.
On the Starship Enterprise under Captain Kirk.
Star Trekking across the universe.
Picking up a life form here. There seems to be lots and lots of lights dancing across this little thing here. No, oh, hang on. I think we're here. I think... Geoffrey, you are president of the Association of Trekkers for the UK. And this is your outfit?
That's correct.
And this is your collection? And how many pieces would you say you had in your collection?
I can't really count them. There's so many.
Really?
Yeah.
And how much do you think it might be worth?
Like over 25 grand's worth of stuff.
That is one heck of a lot of stuff. Amazing. Yeah. So why Star Trek? Why not Lost in Space or any of the other big space sagas?
Well, Star Trek is more realistic to life. If you go back to the 60s version, all the technology they displayed, we've got it all today.
Let's have a look at some of these things you've got here. What is this thing that I've been wingling around with?
Well, that is a standard tricorder.
A standard tricorder.
And basically, that just detects life forms and obviously intergalactic rays as well as radiation.
And this is?
That's a classic phaser, which Kirk would have used on most episodes as well as Spock.
And what sort of injury would this do?
Well, it can either stun you or kill you.
Okay, one or the other. So you don't want to hit the wrong button, do you?
No, exactly.
Nope. Good. Let's have a look at this. Oh, this, I recognise this. Is this a beam me up Scotty thing?
That's correct.
So how do I use this? What do I have to do?
Well, basically, all they would do is basically go, Kirk to Enterprise, four to beam up.
Fantastic. And how much will one of those cost?
Well, when they first came out, they were about $14.99, but obviously you can't get them now. But they're actually worth now £35 to £50.
So, Geoffrey, what's your favourite piece?
The signed photograph of Jadzia Dax from Deep Space Nine, played by Terry Farrell.
And to show off his collection and to celebrate his presidency, Geoffrey got his fellow Trekkers together for a night of galactic gorging.
So, Darren, a veritable galaxy of delights in store for the Trekkers tonight.
Yeah.
Yes, well, what is this?
This is a Tiberian bat, which we had the USS Enterprise ship in for us. Yeah. This is Targ. It's like a space spider, which has basically been flattened out and char-grilled.
And these here?
That's Tribble Trouble Trifle.
Tribble Trouble Trifle?
Tribble Trouble Trifle.
Tribble Trouble Trifle.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to disturb your Vulcan cheesecake, but you're second in command, aren't
yes,
you?
Yes, indeed.
You're the Admiral?
Yes.
Okay. And you collect Trekker stuff as well?
Yes, I do.
And
yes.
What's this?
This is the Enterprise D, which is a galaxy-class starship. First seen in the Star Trek The Next Generation series.
Excuse me, you seem to be eating on your own. Why would that be?
Because of this Federation scum! Starfleet officers, it is not right for a Klingon to be sitting with all these people!
Well, I've had an enterprising meal, I've had my bat, I've got my Romulan ale, and there's just one thing left to say. Live long and prosper, and...
Engage!
To earthly evidence of paranormal activity now, and a collection of crop circle photographs belonging to Reg Presley, lead singer with the Troggs. Laura Beaumont left the Trekkies and zoomed across Wiltshire to meet him.
Strange goings on in the county of Wiltshire, and only one man has the answer. Unfortunately, he's a bit of a
wild thing. You make my heart sing.
So, Reg, you've always been a trog, but now you're a croppie.
Yeah, it's something I got into way back in 1990. Just took a Sunday afternoon drive, you know, and went into a crop formation and dowsed it and found that there was an energy in there. And I started to find out from people that have been studying it since 83 and decided that there was more to this than meets the eye. It wasn't just, you know, hoaxes. In fact, I really do believe that 90% of them are.
Really?
And I should probably get it in the neck from the croppies. But there are the occasional ones and twos that defy that. Yeah.
So, Reg, what exactly are crop circles?
Well, the million-dollar question. We have a feeling that they're laid down by microwave, but it's like a nano zap of microwave, because any more and sometimes the fields will catch a light or something, you know. So it just softens them enough to go down. Now, it looks to me as though there's an intelligence working the microwaves to do it. I don't think a craft or anything comes down and presses it down.
Right.
And then goes off. I think it's done absolutely deliberate. We need a little bit of honesty from the governments, from the Secret Services, because they actually do know what's going down here. And we're trying to get it out as ordinary people to the press and that, and the press are laughing at what we're doing. And so we really do need a little bit of help,
okay.
You know, honesty from the powers to be.
The truth is out there.
It's here. It's already here.
So, Reg, you're walking along now and you've got the bits of two coat hangers and the outside of two pens. What are you doing?
And I'm completely off my head.
So what's dowsing?
It's trying to find energies.
Right.
You can find ley lines, you can find water. There's something strange here in between these two stones. They begin to cross.
Yeah? Well, let's have a go. Let's see if I can do this. Do I have to be qualified dowser?
Well, not everybody can actually do this.
Oh. Yeah. Oh, they are moving. I think something... Oh, no. God, I hope this is oil. We could make our fortune, couldn't we?
Yeah, yeah.
Do they have ley line dancing here as well?
I don't know.
Do you mind if I barge in, Reg?
Oh, what a pun. I mean, actually, we are stood here in the barge inn.
Yeah, what goes on in here? This is an incredible room.
Well, it's the centre, actually, for all the croppies. All over the world, they gather here throughout the summer months. In fact, it lasts from mid-April, I believe, right through until September.
And these are all crop circles that have been seen around the area, are
That's
they?
Right. Yeah. Most of them are within a few, four miles or something.
So, Reg, it's not just crop circles that you're interested in, is it? You expand to all things paranormal.
Yeah, I mean, it's built up over the past, 7 years, and anything connected with the paranormal. I believe that everything is connected in any case. A lot of these books, I must say, that I haven't read because I haven't had the time, because they keep flooding into me, you must read this, you must read that. So people do actually send me their books and everything.
So, Reg, before we came back here, you said you had a little something you wanted to show me.
I do. Mm. In actual fact, it's this little thing. It's a top. It's a toy, yet it could be the way, perhaps, UFOs fly.
Okay.
Wild thing, I think you move me. But I won't know for sure.
It's not a good flight, but it should last a few minutes.
Let's settle down and watch it.
No trick photography, I promise you. An amazing object, that. Reg got hold of his on holiday in America, by the way. I don't know whether they've made it to the UK yet. If you've ever seen another one here, let me know. And if you'd like to send me any information about your collection, then do write to me. The address, as always, is Collector's Lot, P.O. Box 17, Plimpton, Devon, PL7 5YG. Looking forward to hearing from you soon. Bye-bye.